It is Fox Nation live from a packed and very atmospheric Wolverhampton Civic Hall, and we're all set for the big fight of the night as the clock ticks towards 10 o'clock. Shane McPhilvin, the surprising British cruiserweight champion, I guess, making his first defence against Enzo Macronelli, a former world champion who's giving away a lot of weight here tonight, but is a very, very big favourite indeed. We have alongside me Matty Aspin, who, of course, you're going to be watching this fight very closely. For those of the guys who went with us right at the start of the show, just explain why.
Well, I've got a British eliminator coming up against John Lewis Dixon, 21st of April, at Oldham Leisure Centre. And the winner of us will hopefully be facing the winner of these two tonight. So I'll be watching this very intently.
And now, Steve Lillis, our reigning expert, of course. Steve, just set the scene for us here. Set the balance of power between McPhilvin with all those noisy supporters and Macronelli, the bigger name and the former world champion.
These nothing sort of sensational. I mean, 200 tickets, he was still out collecting money on Monday. No, he's got the weight advantage, the size advantage, he's got the crowd on his side, but I'm a big believer in boxing that it's all about levels. And Enzo has been fighting at the highest level of cruiserweight, beating Gomez. We talk about the losses, but you know, the wins against guys like Wayne Braithwaite. Only good fighters beat guys like Wayne Braithwaite. I mean, you know, Shane has a decent amateur background, but he's very limited professional experience. I mean, he's only even had a couple of cruiserweight fights. Most of these fights have been at heavyweight. I mean, I think the advantage, the crowd and the weight advantage cancel out a lot. And as much as we all love Shane, I can only see one way this fight.
Well, we had Shane here, and he made it very clear to you, just having a little wander around in the streets of middle of Wolverhampton before fight, very relaxed, very unusually relaxed sort of fella. And he said from the word go, I'm going to give it a crack. Can you really see him doing that?
I do, yeah. You know, Shane's a very tough guy, and he's got a lot of heart. And I think that's the way to do it tonight. You know, get right on McAnally's chest and let him have it and see if that resistance is still there.
And Macronelli, we mustn't forget, Frank Warren, his promoter, has got a very close relationship with him. Not so long ago, he said, I don't really want to see you in a ring again.
Well, I think he was keen. I think he tried to talk him out of it. You know, he started his commentary career here. But, you know, Enzo is adamant he wants to continue. You know, it's Enzo's decision that he's got to do. Frank did certainly force him into the ring. He wants to continue. But I wonder if he does win tonight, what he'll do, whether he'll go on and fight Matty or John Lewis Dickinson, or whether he'll give up the title, because he does want Nathan Cleverley.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that's very, very dangerous to look beyond what he's got here tonight. And in McPhilvin, he's got a very committed guy, a guy who won the title unbelievably. Remember that fight, won it in the very last round when he was miles behind on points, wasn't he?
He was. He's very gay, like I say, he's very brave. He comes out and he gives it his everything, you know. He wears his heart on his sleeve as well. Very genuine guy. And tonight, he deserves it. And being the champion with a crowd like this as well, it could give him an extra lift and maybe something special can happen.
OK, Matty, we're going to put you on the spot in it because you've relaxed into this job. You're now an acknowledged pundit, sort of pundit up here. What does your gut tell you about tonight's fight?
I say Macronelli in five, but again, it's if Shane can test his chin early on, maybe we don't know, do we? We'll
OK,
see.
Macronelli in five. We mustn't forget about Macronelli's chin.
Goes over, all five losses have come inside the distance, but he's still a level above domestic rivals like Shane. I'm going for Enzo in four.
Okay, Enzo in four, Enzo in five for you. Great to be here at the Wolverhampton Civic Hall years ago when I worked on local radio in this part of the world. I enjoyed my boxing here. I enjoyed watching a fella called Bunny Johnson. Great fighter, great champion. He's with Steve.
Yeah, and Jim, I enjoyed him as well. Former British and Commonwealth heavyweight champion and British light heavyweight champion. And you might be wondering, well, what about the cruiserweight division? Well, there was no cruiserweight division. Bunny, do you ever wish there was a cruiserweight division when you were fighting?
Well, a cruiserweight division would certainly have suited me much better, because during my career, or most of my career as a heavyweight, I always had to give away 2 stone and 2.5 and 3 stone sometimes.
What was the heaviest you ever weighed for any of your title fights or your heavyweight fights?
13.5 was my best weight, and that's what I always try to aim for. When I'm not training full-time, I probably go up to about 13.7, 13.8, but for fighting purposes in the ring, when I felt my best, it was about 13.5. That's the weight I was when I won the title from Danny McAlinden.
So even at your heaviest, you're still 6 or 7 pounds inside the cruiserweight limit. That's madness.
Incredible. But as I say, every decade, people get bigger, and therefore that is why they have the increase in the weights as the years pass. But it passed me by.
Listen, you still won a couple of titles. Thanks very much indeed, Barney. Back to you, Jim. Let's get this on now. This crowd is ready, as you can sense and feel.
Thank you very much indeed. Bonnie Johnson looking in absolutely brilliant shape there. Stand by, as I say, for a very unorthodox ring entry from Shane McPhilbin. Let's rejoin your MC. Those, all the McPhilbin fans, by the way. Macronelli, very much the away fighter here. He's all set to go. So are we on Box Nation. Over to Mark Burdett.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening. Please welcome into the ring the challenger from Swansea, Enzo Macronelli!
Long career, Enzo Macronelli has never held the British Cruiserweight Championship. Now the title, is he going to take it? Been a pro since way back in 1999 and, of course, a former world champion. And he still believes as a light heavyweight, he can be a world champion. Certainly looks in terrific shape. And he's been talking the talk. Those are the McPhilbin fans who believe that it's going to go all wrong for him.
Please welcome into the ring the British Cruiserweight Champion from Bulwell in Nottinghamshire, Shane McPhilbin!
Well, to say he's enjoying the moment would be an understatement. Enzo Macronelli, one of the fans he's really admired, but Shane McPhilbin has just loved being a British champion. He's loved the recognition that's gone with it. And I think just about everybody who enjoys having a pint with him has made their way down here. Those who know him personally, as his mascot, one of his mates. Shane McPhilbin, by his own admission, had a 3-day celebration after winning the title. And he's not ready to give it up in a hurry, Bunsie.
No, he's not ready to give it up in a hurry, John. You know, he took that fight at short notice. We talked to Carl Greaves about that at the start of the show. And this time he's ready, this time he's been preparing. And he may party hard, John, but like Ricky Hatton, there's no boozing when he's training. He's not one of those guys. You know, he drinks, he loses it, he has a great time. He stops drinking, he trains for fights.
Well, this is his moment, and he now wants to retain that famous belt. Can he do so? Let's hear all about both men.
Ladies and gentlemen, Frank Warren, in association with PJ Promotions, proudly presents 12 three-minute rounds for the British Cruiserweight Championship, live and exclusive on Box Nation, from the Wolverhampton Civic Hall. Your officials are appointed by the British Boxing Board of Control, and your three scoring judges at ringside are John Keane of Wellingborough, Victor Loughlin of Paisley, Scotland, and Terry O'Connor of Birmingham. Your British Boxing Board of Control steward in charge this evening is Dave Roden. Your timekeep, the bell, is Martin Fallon. And when the action begins, your referee in charge is Mr. Ian John Lewis of Gillingham. And now to introduce the contestants. Firstly, fighting out of the red corner with a record of 34 wins, 5 losses, with 27 knockouts to his name. He is the former European and WBO World Cruiserweight Champion. At yesterday's weigh-in, He scaled 13 stone, 7 pounds, 10 ounces, and is wearing the black shorts. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome from Swansea in Wales, Enzo Macaronelli! And across the ring, in the blue corner, this evening stands the British Cruiserweight Champion with a record of 8 wins, 2 losses with 5 KOs to his name. He weighed in 14 stone, 3 pounds, 8 ounces, and is wearing the St. George's and Irish coloured shorts. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the British champion, hailing from Bulwell in Nottinghamshire, Shane McPhilby! Your referee will now give his final instructions to both boxers.
Boxers, I'm the referee. I suppose you're both in the dressing room. Obey my command at all times. You both know the rules. Watch the heads. Keep the punches up. When I shout break, you break clean. Check hands.
Ladies and gentlemen, 12 three-minute rounds for the British Cruiserweight Championship.
Shane McPhilbin says he will go for the chin of Enzo Macaronelli from word go and find out if the punch resistance is still there. He said that Macaronelli was one of his favourite fighters, one of his heroes, that it was an honour to share the ring with him, but he says now he's stopped being my hero, he's an opponent, and I'm looking to take him out.
Bold talk, and the only possible talk I'd expect from McPhilbin. He has to fight. And I still think Enzo needs to box a little bit, John, I really do.
Well, McPhilbin might be the stronger man. Enzo Macaronelli, always tremendously fit, but you can see physically McPhilbin, a big man. As an amateur at his heaviest, he was over 19 stone as a fighter. Now, of course, very much in better shape, but he is physically a big lad.
Yeah, I saw him in Price Fighter a few years ago when he was pushing Michael Sprott around. Don't worry about that, and Sprott is a big old lump.
Yep, Michael, fully fledged heavyweight. They'll be, I think, crammed into every pub in Bulwell watching this one. And if McPhilbin can pull off a win here, well, what a story that would be. Macaronelli, of course, has other ideas. He wants this title, and long term, he wants Nathan Cleverley. I know you thought he got clipped in that first round a little by Kieran Healy.
Yes, I did. I just thought, you know, clumsy shot he got through. I'm not saying he was hurt, but he showed he'd been clipped. And I think, in addition to winning this title, John, in addition, good shot.
That's a nice right hand from Macaronelli, but McPhilbin takes it.
His eyes fluttered there, John.
There's the hand speed of Macaronelli, but there's a right hand there from McPhilbin as well. Macaronelli says sometimes he's his own worst enemy and allowing himself to get dragged into tear-ups, yeah, even when he knows that boxing would be the better option.
I'm convinced he could box here for 2 or 3 rounds. I'm absolutely convinced. I think what he's really looking for, John, is just to regain a bit of the pride that was sucked out of him with all those stoppages.
Oh, oh, Macaronelli down! Left hook did it! And down in the first round, the McPhilbin fans go wild! The count's at 7-8! Ian John Lewis having a good look at Enzo Macaronelli. Down with the left hook in the first round. Oh, does he know where he is? He doesn't know where he is. The bell's gone.
With 47 seconds left.
There's 47 seconds left in the round.
What's going on?
Well, that is all wrong. Macaronelli didn't know where he was. The bell went wrongly. The fight, well, it should have been allowed to go on.
And all credit to McPhilbin, he's the one that heard the bell. It wasn't Enzo Macaronelli who heard the bell. There was 47 seconds, clean seconds left on the clock. It was only a tap, John. Well, hold on a second, that was not a minute, that.
Seconds left, round two.
That's absurd, and that wasn't a minute, John, either.
Well, I don't know what this, I really don't know what this timekeeper is doing. British title fight. It is inexcusable if that was less than 3 minutes, and if that stoppage came early, inexcusable. But McPhilvin looking to just take this into his own hands and finish Enzo Macronelli right here and now, and that right hand has wobbled Macronelli again. He's trying to turn this one into a fight on the cobbles. He's trying to end it right here and now, McPhilvin. And Macronelli complaining about punches around the back of the head. Macronelli trying to trade and forgetting the basics of keeping his guard up. McPhilvin with a 10-8 round, that first
round. A 10-8 round, John, and what's more, it's now a one-punch fight.
Well, they wondered about the questions of Enzo Macronelli's punch resistance. Surely they've been answered there.
They haven't. It hurts me to say it here, John.
He won't like hearing that, and he won't like watching replays, whatever the outcome of this fight, but that knockdown tells you, I'm afraid to say, all you need to know.
Well said, John Rawling, that's absolutely it. I'm glad you said that. I was about to say it. Even if he knocks him stark out now,
right hand,
it doesn't matter.
Macronelli all over the place again with that right hand. Punches around the back of the head from McPhilvin, but Macronelli was holding on.
And he looks distressed, Enzo, he looks distressed. It's not like those guys that get clipped and they're okay, John. He is not okay.
No knockdown, quite right. No knockdown there, the Macronelli fans wanted it, but no way that was. Well, Macronelli surely needs to get back to his boxing skills. Good right hand from Macronelli. McPhilvin takes it well. Such a popular fighter, Enzo Macronelli. Always a credit to his sport. But he's in anxious times, desperate times here in the second round. And he is staggering from one clinch to the next.
He looks like he's being hurt with anything that hits him. And it's hurting me to say it, John. McPhilvin, meanwhile, doesn't seem to be able to get anything off clean.
Well, he's not been able to find the shot he wanted. There's a left hand, could come now. Macronelli just managing to tie him up as we come towards the end of another dramatic round, two rounds gone. Don't see how you could give that round to Macronelli.
No, you couldn't, John, you couldn't. I'll tell you one thing, John.
Let's see if you can hear what Dean Powell's saying.
Put your hands up, step in with a jab. What you're doing is you're walking. Don't walk in. Solid jab, put him on his back foot. The only time he's catching you is when you're stepping off him and you're standing up like a soldier. Get your head down, step in with a jab and then hit him with a right hand. Water. You got me?
Hands up, hit him with a jab. Keep your hands up when you move out of distance.
Now listen,
sound advice indeed.
It's the boxing that he needed. It's what you said earlier on, Steve, that Macronelli really, in the early stages, should just have been looking to box, but he just hasn't been able to keep this bull of a man off him.
Yeah, but John, in all fairness, I don't think he's tried. He caught him in one right hand and he was dropped with a loose left jab. Mild hook. This is still poised, though, John. Trust me, it's still poised.
Third round, Macronelli still there. One of the most heavy-handed fighters in British boxing in recent years. Another one around the back of the head. Macronelli complains again. Macronelli regroup and do what his corner is saying. He's clipped by another right hand as McPhilvin comes in. And once more, it almost looks as though the legs of Macronelli stiffened just a little.
They certainly did stiffen, John. They didn't look like it. They did stiffen. But he just seems a little bit more focused now, Enzo, compared to the end of the first round and the second. A little bit of clarity, a little bit of clean, a little bit of sparkle in his eyes.
Oh! Down again. Left hand and right hand, and down for the second time in the fight. The count's at seven. Ian John Lewis having a very good look at Macronelli and allowing him to continue.
He knew where he was there, John. In the first round, he had no idea what city he was in, let alone who he was fighting.
Good shot.
Are we witnessing a defeat which might herald the end of Macronelli's career, or is he somehow going to be able to turn this one around?
Well, I know one thing, if he pulls out a big right hand and knocks McPhilbin out now, McPhilbin will end up with a rematch because of that 47 seconds left in that opening round, John.
Well, it could have finished right there, couldn't it?
Yes, I'm afraid it could. And as I said, Enzo doesn't look as dazed now as he did at the end of the first.
But he's been down in this round. Oh, and he catches McPhilbin with a big right hand. And now it's McPhilbin who holds on and looks up to his fans for a little bit of inspiration. Best punch that Macronelli's landed for some time.
It was, it certainly hurt McPhilbin. Now it's McPhilbin's turn to try and jab his way forward. Who'd have thought that one?
Look at them standing in the background, trying to get a view of what's turning out to be an enthralling fight. Macronelli clipped again with a left hand as he tried to uncork a left hook of his own. Shocked at how easy Macronelli's been to hit.
A, how easy it is to hit, and A, and B, how easy it is to hurt. He's done him there with a left hook. It's a good shot.
Well, somebody's counting, and the referee's not given a knockdown.
Our timekeeper is trigger happy, to say the least.
What on earth is going on with the officials here? The British Boxing Board of Control need to be having a look at this one. We've had a short round in the first round. We've got a guy who's calling knockdowns when no knockdowns are being given. There's a big right hand from Macronelli. Timekeeper was counting for two knockdowns there, and the referee gave no knockdown. The only knockdown was McPhilbin's on Macronelli, so that's another 10-8 round for McPhilbin.
I think the one thing there, I've got to be honest with you, Enzo did look there, that last 30 seconds, like he was in control. He was knocked down there, John, he was semi-off balance. He wasn't hurt and dazed and stunned like he had been in the first round.
That was the big right hand of Macronelli, and there was where McPhilbin looked up to his supporters, trying to get inspiration. Now, did that left hand touch down? It may well have done.
He did touch his hand down twice, but it wasn't as he was falling. It's because his hands were down there. Now, is that a knockdown? I suppose technically it is, but it's not a knockdown. We both know it's not.
Well, the
knockdown.
Only person who can call the knockdown is the referee, and the timekeeper shouldn't be counting until he picks up the referee's signal. There's the referee, and he said the only knockdown was of Shane McPhilbin. Look, there he went down. That was McPhilbin's punch, and down went Macronelli. Down twice in the fight. McPhilbin, the underdog. What was that bet? 9-1 against a knockout win? You wouldn't get 9-1 now, would you?
You wouldn't.
Oh, you know what, you shouldn't have got 9-1 before the bout. Before the bout, John.
The only way McPhilbin was going to win this fight, we reckon, was by knockout. And I still think that one now, if it goes the distance, you could see Macronelli clawing his way back.
I think Macronelli's hurting McPhilbin, actually, John, the last round in a bit. I really do.
But, oh, it's a good shot. Great left hand from Macronelli. No knockdown given.
Interesting, he's definitely touched down after being hit with a left hook.
McPhilbin has gambled so much in the early stages, and he's starting to look ragged. I'm told, incidentally, that our production staff have had a count on that first round, and there was definitely, and I repeat, definitely, 47 seconds remaining in that first round, and I'm sorry, that is not excusable.
There is absolutely no way that can be explained away.
Macronelli trying to work behind the jab now. Has McPhilbin in this fourth round, has he given it his big shot already? Again, he looks up to those fans who've made their way across from Nottingham, who are giving him rapturous support.
Oh, It's like he's telling them, this guy's had 13 world title fights. He's been in two European title fights. I'm Shane McPhilbin from the pub.
And I've had him down twice.
Yes.
He'll be able to dine out on that, whatever happens.
And he's entitled to, John. Especially once the 47-second controversy kicks in.
Macronelli starting to look more threatening now. He has regrouped. A nightmare start, though, for Macronelli. Down in the first and down in the third. And however you rationalise that, whatever the outcome of this fight, he's going to have to take a long, hard look at it.
A long, hard look at the fight. You know what? If he wants to sit down, I'll sit down with him and go through it. And in the second, he was gone, John. He wasn't there in the second.
But now here in the fourth, is he going to be having the fitness to turn it around? I wonder. McPhilbin catches him with the left hand as he came in. Can't turn you back like McPhilbin did there. That was a better round for Macronelli. Much better won
that round, John. And what's more, I think he dominated that round. I mean, he looks like he's back in control. He looks like he's cleared his head. And I tell you what, full power to Dean Powell, who after the first and the second round, dragged him, pulled him round.
Here he is again. Well, that was that terrific left hand from Macronelli. Well, he's given it as a stumble, as a no knockdown. I'm not so sure.
The gloves mildly touching down is one thing, but those were two knees hitting the floor after a left hook as he rushed in.
There, half a step, there again, okay? Now, come on.
No way for him.
He's better. Listen, he's getting tired, but he's also getting desperate, okay?
No way for him. Well,
I got him 5 points down after the first three rounds. If he's won the next round, back to four. And Carl Greaves trying to do the motivation job on Shane McPhilbin. Keep it going, Shane.
In fact, at this point, perhaps Carl and Shane are thinking we could win on points.
Not Macronelli around the knee there. I don't think of too many times I've seen that.
It's a rare manoeuvre in a boxing ring.
Macronelli has been implored to concentrate on his boxing by Dean Powell, who's running that corner tonight in the absence of Enzo Calzaghe.
Yeah, that was a bit of a messy situation. Enzo not managing to get his first A certificate from the board in time.
Well, he didn't have it last time, Macronelli thought, so he's had time to get it sorted out.
He took a John's Ambulance course instead of the Border Control one. It turns out the board no longer recognised the St John's Ambulance certificate.
When you're in a club, abide by the rules.
Absolutely. And he had paid for a board one, apparently, John, but decided not to take it.
McPhilbin's looking tired in this fifth
round. Looking very tired. He's moaning and complaining.
Starting to complain to the ref as well. Again, getting hold of Macronelli's knees.
Shane saying he's pushing me down.
Good jab from Macronelli. Forced him back with that one. Hit him with a real ramrod left hand as he came in. McPhilbin is tiring and tiring noticeably. This is the man who, remember, had never been past six rounds before he got into that title fight. And here we are in the fifth. Macronelli, who's got years of experience at championship level, perhaps the punch resistance is not what it was, but the fitness is still there. Stalking McPhilbin now. Almost detonated that right uppercut.
He's looking to finish it now, Macronelli. He's regained his senses, John. He's got his cool head back on.
Stand by what I said earlier on, though. And Enzo's not going to let the fact that he was put down and made to look so bad in the early stages here by Shane McPhilbin. It's got to ask real questions.
And the second round, John, was scary, to be honest with you.
I didn't know where he was in the first.
No, he didn't.
And who knows what might have happened if that fight hadn't been stopped wrongly in the first round. Surely now there has to be a rematch, whatever happens. Good jab from McPhilbin. Rocked back Macronelli's head that time. Well, that's Macronelli's round again.
Macronelli's round again, John, but it's not just that he's winning the round. He looks comfortable. He suddenly looks comfortable. He's pulling back. He's loading up with shots. He's throwing different combinations, and he's pulling his head back. He's doing the type of thing that we didn't see in the first couple of rounds.
Draw him into you. Yeah, he's got draw him into you. Listen, draw him in. Listen, draw him in. Feint the jab. Come back with a left foot. Draw him in.
You listen? Mm. Come on. Yeah, he's still in, are you? Got a fucking read. Come on.
Come on.
Come on. We can do this.
Shane's telling him in the corner. I don't know if you heard it there, John. You had a swig of water. I can't breathe.
Come on, you can.
He said I can't breathe.
He said I can't breathe.
Well, he certainly needs a little bit of an injection of self-belief when it was going so well in the first three rounds. He's allowed Macronelli to get back into a rhythm.
He has indeed.
Well, they're certainly up for the fight. The Bulwell boys on tour. Three points the difference I've got between them on my card. Do you agree with that one, Steve?
Absolutely the same as you, John. So let's assume Macronelli wins the next few rounds. Makes it interesting once we get to 10 and 12, 10, 11 and 12.
If it goes as far as that.
If it goes as far as that.
Both of them heavy-handed bangers. I bet Enzo's not even aware of what happened in that first round, you know, with that 47 seconds. I don't think he knew what was going on.
John, he had no idea where he was at the end of the first round, and he had no idea where he was in the second round. It was pure instinct, guts, that got him through the second round.
He's certainly shown that he's a fighting man in here tonight.
We've known that, though, John, we've known that. We want to see something different. We want to see the stuff he had years ago, and we both feel... And, you know, let's be brutally honest, there is a deficiency now with his punch resistance. I'm not happy about saying that, but that's the truth.
And again, caught by McPhilbin as he came in. This time took it well. A little bit of a nick around the right eye of Enzo Macronelli. McPhilbin has started to find the target again here in the sixth round.
Ooh, is that good right shot. Hand?
Oh, Macronelli was just a little bit groggy for a moment.
He does look it again.
Better round for McPhilbin so far here in the sixth. Timing of Enzo Macronelli not there tonight.
Done remarkably well, John, after the first round, the second round, and a shot knockdown in the third as well.
Could be more yet. Could happen either way. This is better now, though, for Macronelli. There's a good right hand. McPhilbin. Kidology that he wasn't hurt, but the right hand just landed. And just for a moment, McPhilbin looked a wee bit disorganised. Good body shot as well from Macronelli.
He keeps getting caught, Shane, as he goes forward. Macronelli's too good, he's too classy. He shared the ring with too many really good fighters over the last 13 years, and he is catching at will when he comes in.
He's a hard boy, though, Shane McPhilbin. Tough lad. That's Leon Williams. Well, sixth round and a much closer round.
Much closer round. I don't know, I might be tempted to give the first 2 minutes in at the McPhilbin, John. Just. I mean, that was a close one. 2 minutes in at the McPhilbin, John. Just. I mean, that was a close one.
Round could be so important. Bunce's given it to McPhilbin, which gives McPhilbin now a 4-point advantage. If you had it the other way, it'd be down to 2.
Enzo can win it from that back distance, John, he really can.
Penny for the thoughts of Nathan Cleverley as he watches this.
Hey, I'm not a promoter, John, I work on TV, but that's a hard sell, mate.
Good jab from Macronelli, but stumbled in a little behind us and almost got caught with the right hand, which, as ever, McPhilvin swinging across. And a word for the promoter, Francis Warren, there at ringside. Or possibly the glamorous-looking lady sitting alongside him.
I didn't notice.
Who am I to speculate? McPhilvin had to soak up another solid, crisp left hand from Macronelli.
That's all Enzo has to do. That's all Dean's wanted him to do. High, long, strong jab and move. He doesn't have to follow with anything, John. And two more now.
McPhilvin's got his corner man standing right across that far side.
Carl's not happy, he's shaking his head.
Carl Greaves, that is, he's looking across in our direction, so I was saying that. I think he feels that his man is starting to lose the plot a little in this contest. Macronelli's round to get this one so far.
It was a hard three rounds for both of them, John, remember?
Yeah, absolutely. McPhilvin's work rate has dropped.
Terrific fight to watch for the neutrals, terrific fight to watch for the crowd here, John. Terrific fight if you're watching it on TV.
It's the sort of fight you can't take your eyes off because you just sense that there's going to be one big knockout punch from one side or the other still, which is going to decide this one.
Both still capable.
Good left hand from Macronelli. McPhilvin looking disorganised as he bulls his way in. Another Macronelli round.
Absolutely. McPhilvin's got the distance pedigree in over the last 4 or 5 years, John. Every time Enzo's been passed behind 6 or 7 in the last 5 years, he's been beaten. Is
it? 8th round, you've got it by 3 rounds now to McPhilvin. I've got it by 1.
Got it by 1 point to McPhilvin, or by one round, 3 points, yeah.
That's because you gave the 6 to him.
Yeah, that's six of the crucial rounds.
That's the two round difference between yours and mine. Judges are the important ones. Victor Loughran, Terry O'Connor, and sitting right in front of us next to our commentary position, John Keane, the three wise men who are going to be deciding the outcome of this fight should it go the distance. Macronelli's landing more punches now. McPhilvin's shown himself to be one very strong guy, though.
Absolutely.
Just not getting the punches off, though, McPhilvin, as Carl Greaves was saying between rounds. Allowing himself to fall in, and as he does so, he's getting stifled.
He's getting caught and he's getting stifled. But he seems quite happy to hold. And that's what Carl's upset with. You can't hit and hold. You've got to throw straight shots.
He's getting frustrated, McPhilvin. There are a few curses there as Macronelli got inside.
Enzo is tying him up beautifully as well, John. There's nothing. He's not allowing McPhilvin to do anything inside. He's getting him under either elbow, and that's it. He's completely nullifying any attempt of McPhilvin's to work.
The years of experience. Macronelli, remember, tonight in his 40th professional fight, McPhilvin in just his 11th. Good left hand.
And also Enzo Macronelli has trained for years and years with mixed martial artists, so he's good at grappling, he's good at holding.
altogether more purposeful look now to Macronelli. It's been some time since McPhilbin's landed one of his bombs.
Yeah, it's been an awful long time, John.
Well, it would be an interview for Robert Smith if you were here, the Secretary of the British Boxing Board of Control, about what can be done about that first round, whether or not they would mandate a rematch if Macronelli goes on to win this fight.
Well, I know one thing, we won't speak to anybody from the board tonight. They have a policy of not speaking. We can ask, they won't allow it.
Another round for Macronelli for me.
Yeah. I think the last, I think really, John, the last, well, 7 and 8, even in the 6, which I thought he maybe, I thought he lost the 6 on the first 2 minutes. He hasn't looked uncomfortable for a lot of rounds now, John.
I've got a level fight now, Bunsey. Here's Dean Powell again.
Okay, sometimes jabbing there, he's got no answer to that. Okay, listen, Enzo, you can't afford any more mistakes, son, because it's going to be all over. You understand me? So listen, he ain't no Marcelo Dominguez, is he? Well, come on then.
It's good corner work.
Listen, it's still poised because Enzo, as I said earlier on, John, he hasn't been past 5 or 6 and won a fight for about 4 or 5 years. McPhilbin has. This is hard and a draining fight for Enzo.
Dean Powell knows one mistake, and it could still be all over.
Second out, round 9.
9th round. You've got McPhilbin still ahead, Steve, but the gap narrowing. I've got it dead level.
I've got it 4 rounds each, but McPhilbin with the 2 points for the knockdowns, John.
Not too often fighters win when they've been down twice, but it can happen.
I was watching again on the show the other day, John, Enzo's fight against Bruce Scott, I think, for the WBU title, where he went down, first round, he went down, it was lights out, it was all over. Ian Dark doing the commentary said, that's it, the fight's over. That, John, I don't want to remind you, it was 9 years ago. I know.
I was there, I think.
Hey, I was ringside with you as well. 9 years ago, that's ridiculous.
Macronelli, though, has shown his fitness, he's regrouped, and at the moment he's doing what's required. McPhilbin has got to find more science to get in to range and to land than he is doing at the moment. Just lunging in, and it's in a pattern, and Macronelli's coping with it.
He's coping with it comfortably. He's realised that there's nothing Shane McPhilbin can do to him when he does lunge in like that. All Enzo's going to do is hold his feet and hold his hands. More importantly, hold his hands.
Publicly, Enzo Macronelli was saying, he's stronger and heavier than me, I'm ready for a long, hard fight. I think privately he thought that he was going to get McPhilbin out of there by now.
Yeah, who thought we would be going into the last minute of round 9 with the two of them bruised, mildly grazed, and having been on the floor twice. I don't think many people saw a fight like this, John.
McPhilbin, oh, caught by a terrific shot! Great shot from Macronelli! And this time he does touch down. McPhilbin doesn't like it, and his corner don't like it, but the knockdown is given, and he is furious. He is furious. Controversy again seems to go with Ian John Lewis, the referee, but for me, that was a right call.
Perfect call. He got hit with a shot, his knees went down, his hands went down. There's nothing else John Lewis could have done.
That was a correct call for me. So now McPhilbin's been down, and now Macronelli has the advantage in this fight. Who would have thought it back in the first, second and third? The McPhilbin fans urging their man forward, but Macronelli senses that he's taking control here.
Yeah.
Big round for Macronelli. Well, I don't think there was any doubt, Steve. Let's watch again.
I see what McPhilbin's argument
I know what the argument is, but he's dragged on, isn't he?
His hands are on me.
Yeah, he's dragged down. Ooh. He's dragged on there now. Yeah, maybe there's an argument there.
You know what? I think there might well be an argument there, John.
Well, on watching the replay, my gut feeling when I watched it was, yeah, that's a right call. Watching it again, I'm not so sure.
Because there's quite a serious pause, isn't there, between the two punches landing and his knees and hands touching. Hey, listen, there's breaks everywhere.
Corners, 10 seconds.
What's going on? What's Dean screaming at the referee for?
Second round, round 10.
So we go into the 10th round. And this is starting to look now as though it could be Enzo Macronelli's fight. Been a long time now since McPhilbin had a big round in his favour. Won the first three, maybe won the sixth, but the rest of it's been to the former world champion. I think McPhilbin's losing heart.
He is. He's got to work, John. He's not. He hasn't worked inside since the third round, really.
He's been a proud champion, he's enjoyed being champion. But at the first time of asking, is the crown going to be slipping away to the Welshman? The will's there, he's lunging in, but he's just not pulling the trigger.
He's not really thrown a proper punch, John, for a good few rounds now. He's clubbing when he's in close and he's mostly holding. I think he's having serious problems breathing.
Stamina problems maybe as well. There's a wing in behind the left hook there, but it came from an awful long way back and Macronelli saw it coming. Interesting to hear what Carl Greaves has got to say to Shane McPhilbin at the end of this round, how he's going to try and rouse him. Might be some industrial language, so I'll give you a bit of a forewarning of that one.
I think there'll be industrial language in both corners because Dean knows he's got to keep Enzo hyped up. Enzo's had a slower round here. Both two very tired men, John.
Hard fight. McPhilbin not doing enough, though, again in this round. Is it from a positive perspective from Macronelli's point of view, having been hurt so badly in the first three rounds, to come back like this against a bigger man?
Again, listen,
says
against,
something
against a bigger man, it does say something, John, but I just think that, you know, if you judge it harshly and if you look at it in the cold light of day, it wasn't that long ago that someone like Shane McPhilbin would have probably been hired for the first couple of weeks of sparring. And that's not disrespectful to Shane McPhilbin. Tonight, for three rounds, he was dominant. Everything he threw and hit Enzo with hurt him.
Another Macronelli round.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. On my card, I've got it 6-4 Macronelli, and Macronelli 1 point in front because of the points.
And I've got it 3 to Macronelli now with just two rounds remaining.
Two rounds, pull it out the bag.
You'll regret this in the morning. You've got to get up now and you've got to give it each shot. 6 minutes.
You're jumping in. Get a little bit closer. Come on.
Let's get your phone on. Let's get him. Hands free. Let's work. Bang him in. Yeah?
Come on, Shane.
Hands free. Don't look in the round. Don't turn your back. Right? Hands free. Let's have it, son. Right?
Hands free. Get him.
You're never going to get a better chance than this in your life. Right? You listen to me. You're never going to get a better chance in your life. You're going to go out.
Corners, 10 seconds.
Well, that spells it out pretty clearly. You never get a better chance in your life. Get out there and do it.
But then there was a little telltale, are you listening to me? Because I don't think he was, John. That's why I was tapping you. I don't think Shane was listening to him in the corner there.
Two rounds to go. and Macronelli now looking as though he is taking control and has taken control. McPhilbin trying to let the punches go.
He's worked hard in this fight, Enzo Macronelli, John, hasn't he? He's really had to work hard and dig deep.
If you were looking at any other fighter, you'd say terrific win.
Absolutely.
You judge Enzo Macronelli by high standards.
Are we judging him too harsh because we count him as friends? Are people sitting at home and saying, what are these two talking about? He survived two knockdowns against the guy who's naturally heavier. Have we got it wrong, John?
Well, Enzo certainly thinks so.
That is his choice.
Still not quite sure how he survived those first three rounds.
Well, I think we both know how he survived the first round, John.
47 seconds, that's the story of it. And if the jubilant Welsh press don't report that, then they're missing part of the story.
Absolutely.
Has McPhilbin got the belief and has he got the engine to make one more big attack before this fight's over? It's been a long time since he's been able to put anything really meaningful on Macronelli.
I don't want to say it, but he has history for salvaging a lost cause.
Absolutely. How many points was he behind against Williams?
More than he's behind now.
And then two knockdowns and a last round stoppage. And the rest is history. Then he became the British Cruiserweight Champion. It's been a little bit of a fairy tale story, a bit of a Rocky story. Well, Rocky would find one last big attack.
I'm afraid he would. I'm afraid for Enzo that he would.
McPhilbin being taken back to his corner to have a bit of binding attended to on the glove, on the wrist. And there's a little bit of boisterous chanting between the two sets of supporters in here. I do hope that nothing silly is going to happen.
Yeah, they're in different sections, John. There's lots of different exits. Let's just hope that happens that way. No matter what happens, no one's going to complain, are they, John? Decision wise?
Well, I think, you know, if I was a committed McPhilbin fan, I think I'd be complaining about that first round. That's another Macronelli round.
I'd lay odds they haven't realised in that corner, John. They're so wrapped up in it.
Ian John Lewis telling them it's the last round.
Corners, 10 seconds.
Shane McPhilbin needs a knockout for me now.
He does need a knockout, big knockout. I'm not even sure 2 points would be enough to salvage it, John. He needs a stoppage.
Respect between the two. Now what can they deliver in the last 3 minutes? Macronelli's fans all on their feet on the far side of our commentary position, on the far side of the ring. McPhilbin's fans, they've been shouting and chanting from word go up on the balcony. Macronelli tying McPhilbin up. and the Nottingham man just not good enough technically to find the solution.
He's not even tried, John. But what he hasn't done is what Carl's been asking him to do on and off for about six rounds. He hasn't let his hands go inside. He hasn't tried.
Well, he certainly had his moments. And if, as will surely happen, unless he finds a big shot, if he now loses on points, he's going to be saying, yeah, I lost, but I could have won.
And what a fairy tale it's been the last 9 weeks, John.
Macronelli, in the end, he's just known a bit too much for him.
Absolutely.
A bit too clever.
He finally started to box after what was, as only can only be described as a disastrous three rounds. And three rounds that need to be looked at and analysed again and not skipped over.
And a bit of prize fight about, he'd have lost.
He would have well and truly lost.
In the last minute, nice left hand inside from Macronelli, and McPhilden this time wanted to hold on. 47 seconds to go. Remember that time?
That's a classic time, 47 seconds. It will be remembered as the 47 second British Cruiserweight title fight.
I wonder if the timekeepers, and if indeed the referee, is aware of what happened there. Macronelli caught on the way in. Last 20 seconds. McPhilden has to find a bomb. It doesn't look as though he's got the belief. Corner imploring him to throw the shot. But it's not going to come.
He's looked
left
happy
hand from Macronelli.
Yeah, he's looked happy with 12 rounds for about the last five rounds, John.
There we go. Bell goes. 12 rounds. Who would have thought it would have gone the distance? But gone the distance it has. And for me, Enzo Macronelli has won by some 5 points, and you've got it, I think, three on yours.
3 points and 8 rounds to four. 4 rounds, 3 points.
Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for two boxers who gave everything. Okay, after 12 rounds of boxing, we go to the scorecard, and we have a unanimous decision. Judge Victor Loughlin, 111, 115. Terry O'Connor, 111, 116. Judge John Keane, 110, 115. The winner, and the new British Cruiserweight champion in the red corner from Swansea, Enzo Macronelli!
Macronelli wins it.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the Nottingham fans cannot believe it. The belt goes to Enzo Macronelli. The Nottingham fans are distraught. The travelling Welsh contingent celebrate. Last word, Budsy, what do you reckon?
It's absolutely right decision. No problem with the decision, John, but we're still going to have to look at those first two or three rounds. Enzo's going to have to look at them. And I know one thing, Dean Powell there, he's an honest, he's not a liar, and he'll tell him the truth. And one or two other people, maybe not the ones at ringside tonight, they'll tell him the truth.
Macronelli's got the belt. Questions, though, big questions about his performance, about those first three rounds. And what about the missing 47 seconds?
Well, he's got that belt. It was mighty tough. And there is big, big controversy about this fight that we will talk you through afterwards. That first round stopped 47 seconds early. And we will show it you from the first bell. And we will show you why this controversy has occurred. And we will show you why there might well be a second item, a second instalment of McPhilbin and Macronelli round the corner when the border control gets to grips with it. Before we talk about that, let's talk about the whole fight, first of all. And he nearly did it, didn't he, Shane? He nearly did it on that start, and he will feel very aggrieved how early that first round finished.
Yeah, I don't think the corner knew how early the fight was, the bell was rung in the first round. You know, it would have been a different story. Enzo was out on his feet, and I think Shane would have took him out in that first round. But Enzo being, you know, a true warrior, come back and just nick the rounds in the fight.
Yeah. What are your feelings about the whole fight? I mean, it might not have been one for the boxing purists, but it got the old ticker going, didn't it?
It was dramatic. The atmosphere was fantastic, but, you know, the judges were spot on with their scoring, but the wrong thing happened. It should have been the 47 seconds in that first round, and I think Shane would have stopped him, floored him again, and the referee would have stopped him. You could even make a case for him stopping it from the first knockdown. The Bulls are quick to all boxers up and have them over little things like licences. They've got to get shot at that timekeeper. That was... The guy has been robbed of the title he had. They've got to order a rematch instantly on Monday
morning.
We will
have a close look at that, as I promised, but first of all, let's have a word with the two fighters. Great respect between these two, before, during, and I'm sure after the fight. There with John.
Thank you very much, Jim. Yeah, both lads here. And, well, so many talking points in that fight. The knockdowns, the first round, 47 seconds short. But in the end, a new champion, Enzo, first of all.
It's nothing against Shane. I was probably the worst I've ever boxed. But in fairness, could have been a Shane's tactics were spot on. You know, yeah, he got in close, threw his shots, got in close, nullified my body shots, nullified my hooks, caught me cold in the first couple of rounds. Luckily, I learned that we take a knee. I just thought about my dad the entire fight, I'll be totally honest.
In those first three rounds, Enzo, I mean, it seemed that every time he was connecting, you were in trouble. Down twice. Did you know where you were in that first round?
Yeah, I did. That's where I took the knee. Normally, if you noticed before, I jumped straight back up, but I took the knee, I listened to the count, I waited for the count. I was fine when I got up. You know, I totally recovered. But again, you know, I just felt weak in there. But again, nothing against Shane. He had his tactics spot on.
Well, let's have a word with Shane, because you came so close to knocking out the guy who you said as a fighter was your idol.
Well, when it went down first time, it was a massive, massive shot, big buzz. I thought, right, I'm going to get him. I thought it was right end of it. Then when it went down the second time, I thought, yes, I've definitely won this, but kept going and kept strong. I kept trying to throw in punches and realised what I was throwing. It's been a nod to me in the ring. I do say that knockdown, what it gave me, one to knock down. If you watch it back, you'll see it one, blatantly one to knock down, but it's the way boxing goes. And it was an honour just to step in the ring with him and to put him down twice and for him to be proper knockdowns was just a massive boost. And hopefully I can try and get the rematch. Round cut short, it should have been finished then.
Were you aware that round was short, that first round?
No. When you're in there, you don't really feel the times. You're just getting stuck in, and when it went down, I was just on a massive buzz trying to get stuck back in. So you don't realise, but hopefully we can get on again. And it's been a dream come true, and I feel that I could have got him.
Shane, you had those first three rounds, and you were, well, on our cards, you were 5 points up after three rounds, and that was the point at which Dean Powell gave Enzo a little bit of a riot act. Let's just bring Dean in here and just say, what were you telling him there? Get back to your boxing.
Yeah, I mean, he was committed. We know we spoke beforehand, you know, and we said you mustn't go and have a fight with him, and you mustn't back off him because, you know, as he proved when he won the title, he's dangerous to the end. He comes in swinging. And, you know, I mean, I said to him, you know, you ought to get a parking ticket if you're getting it with those right hands. You know, I told him about his dad, you know, God bless him, Mario will be looking down at him and he'd be very proud of him tonight. And I'm very proud of him.
Well, you had to dig deep. You had to dig so deep, Enzo. And you had to, in the end, rely on the boxing.
Yeah, it was his boxing. I don't know. I think it was a knockdown against Shane. I know he won a knockdown. I signaled that. You know, I caught him a couple of times in the fight, but that wasn't a knockdown. Yeah, he had to rely on the box. And like I said, I couldn't get no punches off. He nullified my shots. He had his tactics spot on. To be honest, I sort of come into this fight thinking I was going to blow him away. He had his tactics spot on. I couldn't get nothing off. I was catching him with single shots. I couldn't get him with any power shots. Basically, there were jabs and little short chopping right hands as he's coming in.
There was controversy there. Would you give him a rematch? Would you want him to be in the ring with him again?
Yeah, of course I would. If he, you know, you give me the honour of giving him a fight, then, you know, I'll do the same. It's, you know, no problem at all.
Well, Francis Warren here is the promoter, and controversy, Francis, to put it mildly. What about a rematch?
it's definitely something we'd love to sit down and talk about next week. You know, I just want to give Enzo, you know, credit for coming through, which was what was an incredibly difficult start to that fight, and give Shane massive you know, credit for his performance. But yeah, I mean, I think a rematch is definitely something that that should be talked about, and especially if we can pull this sort of crowd back in again. You know, Shane's fans were fantastic, and I'm sure they'd love to see him back in the ring with Enzo.
Shane, your fans came in numbers. Is there going to be still a party?
Well, we'll still get smashed up tomorrow, so open the pubs up, because I missed out on Paddy's Day. Normally I have a 9-day binge after a fight. Missed out on Paddy's Day, so it's 12-day binge. But I just like to say, I did try my best tonight, and this fight was in honour of my late coach who passed away, Super Singo, Paul Singleton, so I hope he was watching down.
Well, well said. And congratulations as well to Enzo Macronelli, champion again. Last word for you. What does it mean to have this belt?
It just means for my dad. This was for my dad. I've had a hard few weeks, and you know, it was hard being in there tonight. Just thinking about my dad. I said a prayer at the beginning, looked up to the heavens, hoped he was looking over me, and thankfully he was.
Good lad, you're the champion, Enzo. Well done. John.
Cheer, mate.
Emotional night for Enzo Macronelli. Enzo Macronelli, the new British cruiserweight champion, but in very controversial circumstances, on real class down there in the post-fight interviews from everybody concerned. As I promised, we're going to have a look at that round one right from the very start, just to underline exactly what happened. Okay, they're all set to go here. Matty, have a little look at this, and Steve as well. And we'll turn commentators up here all the time looking at the clock. And now, he had said Shane McPhilby, Matthew, he's going to jump on him from the start, and that's just what he did.
He did. He set up like a rocket, you know. Like I said before, he set up with nice body shots, nice straight rights, you know, letting him know that he's in there and he's willing to fight. And then, he was picking his shots nicely. And Enzo, you know, did look a bit weary in the first couple of minutes, and that's when the fight changed.
Steve?
Shane did say it was going to be a four-round fight for him, and it pretty much was that. I gave him the sixth round, I think, but after the three, four rounds, that's all I gave him. So he was right in that. But, you know, his tactics early on were spot on. The second half of the fight, he just couldn't get going, and, you know, was getting his jab off more then.
And let's say we have a look at this, and it's really hot in the Civic Hall. We talk about Shane McPhilby, he was having a bit of trouble with his breathing. That might have affected his stamina as well. But he's full of fire. He's absolutely pumped up. He's fighting his hero, and nothing that's come from Macronelli so far has bothered him.
No, the shots. You know, Shane never looked in trouble once whilst he was in there. And to be honest with you, he looked the stronger fighter, and he did look the champion for the early stages of the fight. But this fight, this first round is a pivotal moment in the whole fight.
We're sort of coming towards the moment now, and I just to underline that everyone, referee and timekeepers, have to keep a very cool head while there is bedlam around them. And we're ticking towards the minute and a half mark now. And just little signs there that Macronelli might have taken a couple and been wobbled. And now McPhilby pours it on, and Macronelli, who has got this a little bit of a habit of being a bit chinny and wobbling, he's starting to, or am I imagining, to look just slightly shaky here.
Yeah, but, you know, every shot that lands looked like it really hurt him. So even all the way through the fight, the jabs are whipping his head back, and his legs just really did look shaky all the way through the fight. I think this is a knockdown.
Now his legs have
just
gone.
A short little left
and
up.
Down he goes. Let's keep looking at the clock, shall we? 52.
Well, the clock stopped.
The clock has stopped there. Clock has stopped. There's the count. Scrub it down. It stopped for a few seconds. There's consternation, and in comes Dean Powell. And well, if it's 40, it's certainly a good deep 40 seconds. If it's not 47, the clock stopping there. But that is 40 seconds of that round that has probably saved Enzo Macronelli and robbed Shane McPhilby. Go on.
It's robbed him, but what did the referee hear? So, you know, Enzo looked to his corner and the referee seemed to look and to send them back. We didn't hear it, but what did the referee hear to make that decision? You know, but it's the timekeeper who were ringing, but the referee has heard to send him back. So it must have been the timekeeper. It has to have been.
I think
he's been robbed.
I've been told that the bell rang twice. How is he going to... I mean, listen, he was blissfully unaware in the corner after the fight. How is he going to feel? How is he going to react when he sees that?
He's going to feel cheated. Without that, I'd be absolutely devastated with that.
It was a heavy, heavy knockdown. And, you know, Shane, all he had to do then was go in for a couple of more punches, game over. Title back home, simple as that. But he's been robbed of this fight, and it's a shame.
I think it's going to sink into him tomorrow. Like, he was still, the adrenaline was still buzzing there. He was talking of the honour. Here is the knockdown again.
As you said, that is
gone.
A big knockdown. I mean, fair play to Macronelli. He used all his experience, and perhaps he used experience to think, they're not sure here, I'm going to go to the stool. You know, you don't know, do you?
You don't know, of course. But, you know, the thing of Enzo, to his credit later on in the fight, he used all that experience, all those world title fights, them 12 hard rounds with men like Wayne Braithwaite.
Yeah.
It come through.
I'm going to ask you a couple of quite heavy questions about, I'm just warning about Enzo Macronelli a little bit later on. But of course, there was a second count as well in the third round, wasn't it? That Macronelli also went down, and these first three rounds were emphatically McPhilbin's.
Oh yeah, without a doubt, he went 5 points up for me after the third round. Again, like I say, every shot that Shane threw looked devastating, and it looked like he was going to take him out come third, fourth round. But then, like I say, Macronelli used his old man tactics, you know, little pop shots hold, little pop shots turn him, you know, and it just old manned him out of the fight.
Yeah, giving away all that way. We've got to go. I mean, there's nothing wrong with Macronelli's fighting heart, his instincts, and there's a bit of a craft in there as well.
It's craft, there's experience, you know, all the years as a pro, all the guys he's fought. I mean, even through the losses, he's learned. And he old man, he's went through that the last few rounds. He knew what Shane was going to do, you know. So in the last round, he knew what Shane did against Leon Williams in the last round. He come and blasted him out. In the last round, he made sure he just held plenty.
Sure, sure.
And he kicked his way through the latter stages of the fight.
It was a difficult fight, wasn't it? Because McPhilbin kept boring in low, and he was almost halfway down, wasn't he? It was a tough fight for Ian John Lewis to control. But there was another controversial knockdown, I think. And and McPhilbin saying it wasn't a knockdown.
I mean, the jab catches him straight away, which makes it look worse. And
but it looked worse because that left hand's caught him. And I can see, I can see why he's arguing. I can also see what Ian John Lewis was doing there, giving the count.
Yeah, but he's touched down with that glove, isn't he? And your glove touches the canvas.
I'll go with the referee
there. It's got to be a count, isn't it?
I can see what he was complaining about. He was right to count.
With the ref again there.
Yeah,
a bit of a wrong reaction there from Shane. He actually
he's furious about that. But again, when he sees that, he might feel differently. Now Enzo Macronelli. Okay, he's got a belt around him. Wise judges have told him not to fight again. A wise judge up here said to me, you know, even if he wins this, he should call it a day. He's got nothing to prove. What are your thoughts on that?
I agree. You know, both me and John Lewis Dickinson, we gain that ring. You know, John's not such a big devastating puncher, but he'd have Enzo out as well. And I think if it's only a matter of time before he gets seriously hurt.
Okay, go on.
I'd like to see him retire. I didn't want him to come back on unders. You know, it hasn't been knocked out of him in the fight. You know, fighters, he hit knock out of him. All respect to Shane, I think Matty and John Lewis Dickinson would be fancy to beat Shane. And it would be a much tougher proposition for Enzo. Maybe Enzo could have the rematch, and he might old man out him again. But would Enzo at the end of his career, you know, still have to, you know, to have a really tough fight with Shane McPhilbin? You know, he's been a lot better than that. He's had a great, great career. He's been one of our most. He's given us a license to throw over the years. You know, and I keep going back to that Braithwaite fight. That was a brilliant performance.
Fantastic. I remember fighting a very good Argentine. Was it Dominguez? Was it that he had a real tough nut that he beat? And listen, you and me, we love this sport, but we have our real sort of concern is care for the fighters. And the biggest mistake is going on too long. And I must admit, you've done great progress up here, by the way, throughout the night.
Thank you very much.
For it to come from you to say that you think a guy should, I think that means a heck of a lot.
It does. It means a lot to me to fight Enzo, but what the health risk in fighting someone like me that's young, that's hungry, and that can punch a little bit, I wouldn't want to see him go out that way.
Yeah, okay. And a little word about what might happen from now in. I mean, the Board of Control have got to look at this, and come Monday, they've got to come out with a statement and say that, well, there has to be another fight, if that is, of course, if Macronelli wants it.
I mean, the cause confused is this eliminate the next month. And, I think, you know, I don't know what Enzo's going to do, whether he's still going to carry on to go down the light heavyweight, I don't know. But the Board have got to order a rematch because of that 47 seconds, when, if that continued, the odds are, I think, Shane McPhilbin would have retained his title.
Okay, thank you very much. Matty, you've been a star up here with us. I know you started off a little bit nervous, didn't you? But you have grown into this role, and there's no question a role up here awaits you when you've finished in there. But I know you've got a lot of things to do. Thanks very much for your company. Appreciate you joining us on Box Nation.
Thanks, mate.
Good luck. Well done.